Yeah, Zoom is now what stand-up comedy's become, and it's pretty bleak.
It was pretty bleak before, no?
Yeah. Do you mean Zoom or stand-up comedy?
Because
yeah. Well, I'm really excited to talk to you. The premise of this show, comedy podcasts are cool, interview podcasts are cool, but they're really long, and I don't have 3 hours for Joe Rogan, so we'll talk. And
who does? Who does?
A lot of Republican men, it seems.
He got the biggest deal at Spotify, and I was looking for a female equivalent. There are none. You know, it's just...
So I read your memoir. Kind of a super fan, so you're gonna be like, ugh. But I would think it would be selling the Cannibal Cop movie to HBO, but if not, I'd love to hear about a meaningful gig and how you got there.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's, for me, that story's interesting, but it's kind of like the Mommy Didn't Dearest was a lot more successful, and it was not going to be, and I guess it just isn't something I've talked about, so it could just be something that we cover on this one, if that sounds good.
For sure.
Yeah. So I made one documentary film I had gotten from one digital media job, and I was still having some, I think I was still having some drinking issues. Maybe I was sober. I forget exactly. But so I was like, I want to make another film, but I don't really know what it's going to be about. And so I was working with this woman named Allison Byrne, and she started talking to me about a crime story where a woman was in a wheelchair, and it was unclear if this woman needed the wheelchair. And it was in Missouri, and there was something very like Southern Gothic about it. I said, you know, that's definitely something I'm very interested in. So I went to HBO and I said, I've got the next story. Like, this is what it's going to be. And I remember the executive was like, oh, I don't know. Is it? Like, are you sure? And I was just like, no, this is viral. Like, I am telling you. And she said, okay, but like, don't spend all your money doing it. And so I flew down to Missouri, and this is about Gypsy Rose Blanchard, which became the infamous case that became the act in my film, Mommy Didn't Dearest. And she basically, like, I got to meet with her lawyer, but the lawyer was like, hey, I can't have you talk to my client. And so I was betting the farm on the fact that I could make this film about this person, but I could not get access to the person. And so there was like tens, maybe hundreds of nights. I don't exactly remember, but it was just like, where I was like, what am I doing? Like, am I going to be able to do this? Am I not? And that's what a creative enterprise is, believing that you know what you're going to do, even if it's not set up for you. You just have to have faith that you can sort of get it done. And if you can't get it done, you have a pivot, you have a plan B, you have something else. And so I was operating, so I was making the film. I, you know, interviewed her family, which is Rod and Christy, these incredible people. I interviewed, you know, the grandparents. I interviewed her lawyer, and I was back in New York, and I was at therapy, and I got a call from her lawyer saying, we are going to plea out. Can you get here by tomorrow? And I told my therapist, I was like, I'm leaving. Goodbye. I don't need therapy anymore. absolutely. I definitely need therapy. And I basically got on a plane, was there. At Gypsy's plea deal, she pled guilty to killing her mother and for second degree murder. And that day I interviewed her for 2.5 hours inside the courtroom, you know, figuring out what done. Because like, once somebody goes to jail, you really can't get access to them because the jail decides if they will allow cameras in, and jails should not allow cameras in. Because, you know, there's lots of shenanigans happening. Like when Gypsy interviewed with me, she had unwashed hair. There was no hot water in the prison. And so it was just one of the most surreal experiences of my life. And I'm just going to circle back saying, you know, HBO said, don't spend all your money doing this. And of course I had spent all my money doing this. So I had to go back. We had cut it together. His name is Andrew Kaufman, my editor. And I like went into HBO and I was like, oh, I hope they like this. I don't know if they're going to like this. And they loved it.
That movie is so chilling.
It is chilling.
I rewatched it when I was preparing for this, and I couldn't sleep after. I mean, for people that haven't seen it, it is about a severely abused girl it's basically like Sharp Objects, but real.
And Gillian Flynn watched Mommy Didn't Dearest when she was writing Sharp Objects.
That makes sense.
No. When they were writing the television show Sharp Objects.
I bet Ryan Murphy did too, because in The Politician, he has that exact story.
They never revealed to me if he did. I think HBO sent me a request from Gillian, but Ryan probably just like knew about it and watched it. Oh, Ryan, like I know him. I do not know him at all.
When you interview the grandparents, they talk about the mom basically like she's like a witch or a demon, you know, like they say she was trying to poison them, just like in Sharp Objects, but that she was stealing from them. She was just basically like a demon woman. And then in the Michelle Carter documentary, which I also thought was just gripping, one of the things that the therapist says is men are terrified of women. They see women as having this like witch-like quality, and they're afraid women will control them, and that's their biggest fear. Do you think that's true in modern times outside of horrific abuse stories?
Well, I mean, I remember, so that's Dr. Peter Bregan, who's like an expert for the defense, and he has this sort of theory about involuntary intoxication. And I remember sitting in his house in New York, upstate, and he said, men are terrified of women. And I was like, this is it. This is the movie. Thanks. Like, and I really wanted it to be in the trailer. Like, I felt it was so emblematic of the case. You know, I think as human beings, we're all scared of each other, regardless of sort of what the sort of components are. But yeah, I mean, there is this sort of weird energy about teenage girls that they are looking for attention, that they're seeking attention, that they're going to try to get one over for you. But when you and I both know, Laurel, like it's such a confusing, scary time, and you're not manipulating others as much as you're sort of figuring out who you are. And so society gives this sort of huge responsibility to teenage girls, and you know, they're just sort of figuring it out. So I love films about girlhood. I mean, I only make films about women, and I don't know. I love it. I find women endlessly fascinating.
Wow, I never noticed that. I mean, that speaks to the craft, because I didn't even notice that they were all female driven.
I guess. Yeah, besides Gil, because it's the cannibal cop, the first one, and it did not go well. So it was Mommy Dearest, Gypsy, Michelle Carter, Michelle, you know, a woman. And then At the Heart of Gold, which is all the survivors of the Larry Nassar abuse scandal, and How to Fix a Drug Scandal, Sonia Farrick and Annie Dugan.
So I just watched How to Fix a Drug Scandal, and it took me a full episode to realize that Shannon O'Neill, my former improv teacher, was not the person committing the drug scandal.